Advent means to me happiness all the time.
I think Advent means time to prepare for Christmas.
I think Advent means when Jesus was born.
Who do you say angels are?
I think that the angels were people who had gone into heaven and work with God to help people who need their help.
The angels were God's messengers.
The angels told Mary she was going to have a baby.
The angels helped Mary to know what to do.
They tell the shepherds that they should go see baby Jesus because he was gonna be born.
They help people.
Who do you say the Magi are?
The Magi were wise men who took gifts to Jesus. They followed a star that led to Bethlehem.
The Magi came from far, far away.
The Magi were the travelers who brought gifts.
They went to go pay him respect because they heard that he was the king. The Magi presented Jesus with gifts of gold, of myrrh, and of frankincense.
Who do you say Mary and Joseph are?
Mary is Jesus' mother,
who traveled to Bethlehem and gave birth to Jesus.
Jesus' parents on earth was Mary and Joseph, so Joseph was Jesus' father.
He supported Mary when they were going to Bethlehem.
On the way, Mary went into labor. She gave birth to Jesus in a manger because there was no room at the inn.
What do you say Christmas is?
I think Christmas is the birthday of Jesus.
It's a holiday that people celebrate to spend time with their friends and family.
I like to sing Christmas carols with my family.
Christmas is when my whole family and I get together.
Christmas is about giving to others.
Because the day that Jesus was born, the wise men gave him presents, and we kept using that tradition.
Who do you say Jesus is?
Jesus is Mary's baby.
Jesus was born on Christmas.
And his real father is God. And he performed miracles and taught people how to be kind and treat people how they would like to be treated. Some of the miracles that Jesus performed were that he healed people of their illnesses.
Jesus taught children how to be nice to each other. Jesus also taught people about love and kindness.
Welcome to the second Sunday of Advent. We are very happy that you are here to worship with us this morning, and we will begin with a word of prayer, and then we will say the Lord's Prayer together. So let us bow our heads and be in prayer. Great God, we need to remember that how things are now is not how they've always been, and it's not how they always will be. We need to remember that your kingdom has come, that it is growing among us now, and that the time will come when it fills the world with justice, peace, and love. And so this morning we pray for your coming. To those around the world whose poverty, pain, trauma, and grief might make your kingdom sometimes feel like a pipe dream. We pray for your coming to those who long to see your love and justice expressed more through your followers. We pray for your coming to those in your church who seek to be faithful and to make more of a difference. We pray for your coming to us who long to know you more and to live as citizens of your kingdom in this time and this place. May your coming be something we hope for, but also be something we experience moment by moment. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our
debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We light this candle to proclaim the coming of the light of God into the world. With the coming of this light, there is peace. Christ is known as the Prince of Peace. Christ's name is also Emmanuel, which means God with us. The presence of Christ with us gives us peace every day. Today, we light the candle of peace. Let us pray. Eternal God, we thank you that all through the years you have given peace to your people. Help us to have your peace in our lives. We pray that in this Advent season, we may, by what we do, show your presence to the sick, to the hungry, and to the lonely, so that they may too may have peace. Amen.
And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests."
It came upon the midnight clear, that glorious song. angels sing. Still through the cloven skies they come with peaceful wings unfurled, and still their heavenly music floats o'er all the weary world. Above its sad and lonely plains, they bent on hovering wings, and ever o'er its babble sound, the blessed angels sing. For lo, the days are hastening on, by prophets long foretold, when with the ever around the age of gold, when peace shall over all the earth its ancient splendor flame, and the whole world send back the song which now the angels sing. Ooh,
peace is a big word. It is a beautiful word. It's a complicated word. And it's one that we like to hear, and it makes us feel good to hear it. But if we're honest, it's really a word that oftentimes we don't do much to create in the world or even in our lives. In Hebrew, the word for peace is shalom. And shalom is described in many ways. Here are just some of the ways that shalom is described: harmony, wholeness, completeness, tranquility, uninjured, sound, safe. I like the way Timothy Keller writes about it. He says, shalom experienced is multidimensional, complete well-being, physical, psychological, social, and spiritual well-being. It flows from all of one's relationships being put right with God, within oneself, and with others. God wants shalom for all of us. Shalom with God, shalom with others, shalom within ourselves. Isaiah 9, verse 6 from the New King James Version says these familiar words in this season of Advent. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. For us, that Prince of Peace, that Prince of Shalom, is Jesus, the baby born on a starry night in Bethlehem. Hear that story again from the Message version. There were sheep herders camping in the neighborhood. They had set night watches over their sheep, and suddenly God's angels stood among them, and God's glory blazed around them. They were terrified. And the angel said, "Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. I'm here to announce a great and joyful event that is meant for everybody worldwide. A Savior has just been born in David's town, a Savior who is a Messiah, the Messiah, and Master. This is what you're to look for, a baby wrapped in a blanket and lying in a manger. At once the angel was joined by a huge angelic choir singing God's praises, glory to God in the heavenly heights, and peace to all men and women on earth who please him. Shalom to all men and women on earth who please God. Isaiah 49:6 reminds us not to be confused, that the shalom of God is meant for all people. In this section, Isaiah is talking about a future servant of God, and in our Christian interpretation, that servant is describing Jesus. And in that verse, it says, it is too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the survivors of Israel. I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth, that my Prince of Peace shall bring shalom to all people in all nations. Now, you know what doesn't please God? Sin. Because sin disrupts shalom. Sin disrupts shalom with God, shalom with each other, and shalom within ourselves. Now, I want you to take a moment and think this morning about where shalom is disrupted in your life. Note it in your mind. Write it down on a piece of paper. That is your spiritual work. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to step away for a moment so that you're not distracted by me being on the screen. And I'm going to ask you to think about that question. Where are you disrupted? Where is the shalom in your life disrupted? Is it with God? Is it with others? Is it within yourself? It's the most important spiritual question you can ask this Advent season. So take a few moments now and ask it. So, as we noted, sin disrupts shalom. That's why it displeases God, because God wants us to have shalom, complete shalom in our lives, with God, with each other, and within our own souls. So what then pleases God? God delights in any time that the rupture of sin, that disruption of shalom, is healed, even a little, creating more peace. When that gap between people and God is closed. Whenever that happens, wherever it happens, however it happens, whether it's between two people or large groups of people, or simply somebody coming to terms with their own spiritual struggles in finding peace with God. Whenever that happens, we are called to celebrate. Just like the father in the great prodigal son story celebrated when his lost son came home and was found. Just like the birth of the baby who grew up to tell that magnificent story. This is what we celebrate at Christmas time. We celebrate that extraordinary moment when shalom came to us. We're no longer reaching up for it or trying to bring it into our lives alone. It came to us in the very human form that we share, that Jesus was born into. When shalom came to live with us, to walk with us, to breathe with us, to celebrate with us, to have fun with us, to suffer with us, to grieve with us, to die with us. I think the psalmist had a great and beautiful shorthand way, in my mind, of describing what happened in Bethlehem that night. And I'm going to paraphrase it. Psalm 85, verse 10. In Bethlehem that night, I believe, steadfast love and faithfulness met, and righteousness and peace kissed each other in the birth and personhood of Jesus. So that creating peace in all its forms, creating shalom in all its forms, is central, central to understanding who we are called to be as followers of Christ. I mean, think about it. Just some short examples. Blessed are the peacemakers, Jesus said in the Gospel of Matthew. In John, before his death, he gave the gift of peace as the last gift to his followers. In the Luke resurrection appearance, Jesus greets his followers with peace first before anything else. And those who followed him in the early Christian communities understood the importance of this mandate to be peacemakers and shalom creators in the world. James calls it a way of life. Paul lists it as one of the fruits of the Spirit, peace. In Philippians, peace is identified as a hallmark of a true Christian community. So Christian communities that fight and bicker and go after each other all the time are not examples of where a true Christian community has emerged. Think about the global church, how it's at each other's throat now. Think about some of our local churches and the way we treat each other as followers of the Prince of Peace. So what I really want us to see this morning is that peace is one of those words that we often hear, including in the Bible, both in the Hebrew scriptures and in the New Testament. It's a glorious word, but it is not a throwaway word. It's not just an aspirational word. the kind of peace Jesus was talking about and that Jesus gave to us, the gift of shalom, is brought to us not as a passive gift, but as an active gift, a gift to be used in our lives to create it more and more and more wherever we are and wherever we go. We are to find it and celebrate it where it already exists and where it is absent, where sin has disrupted shalom, where sin has created a gap between us and God, or us and others, or within ourselves. We are to go after shalom, to find ways to create shalom by ourselves, with others, all in the name of the Prince of Peace. Not to sit idly by like so many of us do, me included, thinking, wouldn't it be nice if the world had more peace? If the world had more shalom, wouldn't that be nice? And we sit by idly by as if we have no ability or call to be the ones that go after it, that say we're going to do our best to try to create it wherever we can. Nope. We can't sit on the sidelines. That's not what we're called to do. Our call is a higher calling. Our call is to follow the Prince of Peace. Last night I asked Lori what she thought about the peace of Christ when she thought about that topic and that subject, and I like her answer. She said, I think it is about personal peace and global peace. And you can't have one without the other. That's shalom, interconnected. A complex set of making relationships right that create a larger and a larger and a larger shalom. Her answer sounded about right to me. So what I want to urge you to do is keep that word peace in your mind and your heart and your soul, not just as you move through this Advent season, but beyond. And start now with the answer you gave to the question I asked you to think about where is shalom disrupted in your life? And start going after how to address that disruption and create more shalom, more peace in the world. And do it all as you close those gaps. And you can do it in the name of that beautiful baby born in Bethlehem. Amen.
It was a night like any other night, except for that angel. Ain't seen nothing like it before or since. Us shepherds, we don't get a lot of excitement out there in the pasture. But that angel, it was so bright, so beautiful. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, Sam, you've been out in that pasture just a little bit too long. And you'd be correct. But that all changed when that angel came right up to us. And the angel said, don't be afraid. I was like, too late. And then the angel said, no, I wrote it down. I need to get this right. Hold on. Okay. The angel said, that's my grocery list. Then the angel said, I have good news of a great joy that shall be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And then the angel said, he's lying in a manger, wrapped in cloth. Go find him. Okie dokie. So we're all sitting around, and then one of the shepherds, I think it was Steve, he's like, hey, what are we doing? Let's get out of here. Let's go to Bethlehem. So we hightailed it out of there. and we found that beautiful baby. I'll tell you, I was a different man after that. God chose me. And nobody's ever chosen me for anything. I'll never forget what that angel said, though. The angel said, "I bring good news to all people." That means you too.